Whoa, I hope I didn't scare you off, but welcome to my procedural animation video. And for my project, I have chose to make a tornado in Unity using the shader graph and the particle effect. These two tools will be used to make this stunning effect you see right in front of you. So without any delay, let us begin. What is a shader graph? Tricky question, right? Actually, no, because the shader graph is a tool that enables you to build shaders visually. Instead of writing codes, you create and connect nodes in a graph framework. Shader graphs gives instant feedback that reflects your changes that you put on your project. But before we do that, let's first make our tornado mesh using Maya. In Maya, we're going to start with the NURB curve. To do this, just go to Create and click on the Curve tool to activate this. So what I'll do is that I'll draw a curve. Now you could draw and manipulate the curve however you feel, or change the shape of the curve if you like. But for now, we're gonna make this curve in order to form the shape of the tornado. Now that we have formed our curve, the next step is to use the Revolve tool to form the tornado shape. This will add the surface to the curve to make the tornado mesh that we need for our final project. To do this, select the curve and go to the top menu to click on the surfaces, and you will find the Revolve tool. And just like that, you'll have the tornado shape. However, we see that the surfaces of the mesh have been inverted, and this would not look good for our tornado if we uploaded it in Unity. And how do we solve this problem? There's a tool in Maya called the Reverse Surface. This will allow to change the inverse of the surface of the mesh. You will find this tool by going to the modeling menu set, selecting surfaces, and at the very bottom you will find reverse surfaces or reverse direction. You can also right click it to change however shape of the tornado or however the surfaces should be activated. Thanks to the reverse surface or reverse direction, our tornado surface is not inverted and is ready to be exported to Unity. Now keep in mind, because I made the same mistake, convert the end curb into polygon. Otherwise, you're not exporting the mesh, but you're exporting the curb, and Unity will not recognize this. I did this by selecting the NURB surface, and on the top menu, click Modify, Convert, and there I find the NURB to polygon. Right-click it if you want to change the shape or the mesh of the polygon into quads or tri. Now that I have uploaded the polygon into Unity, our next step is to create our shader graph for it. To do this, right-click to find the menu that has Create. Right-click it, select Shader, and click on Unlit Shader or Blank Shader Graph, depending on which Unity we're using. With this tool, I can create and name my shader graphs for my tornado project. Click the shader graph and start changing the settings of it by adding Universal, Visual Effects, changing the material to unlit, adding alpha clip and alpha clipping to it. The shader graph I've chosen and named, called Tornado Shader Dissolve, will be used to demonstrate my process. I add the color into the menu on my left, then change the mode into HDR and default into white. We also need a float for the dissolve, but it's going to be a slider from 0 and 1. Rename the reference into dissolve as well. Now we can start, so this will all work in the following way. Next, I connect the dissolve with the alpha. If we search with spacebar for the simple noise, first we can control the scale so we can create the property for the float. Add float, name it noise scale, 20 for default value, and this we can connect it to the alpha clip threshold. Also connect it to the base color and save your shader graph. Create the material from the shader graph and then apply it to the mesh. At first you don't see anything, but that's because the dissolve is at zero. But if we invert it, you can see that it is dissolving away, meaning that the dissolve is working. Let's invert the dissolve with a remap node. Basically, the zeros that come in will become ones, and the ones that come in will become zeros. Then we connect the remap to the alpha so that we can have the inverse of the dissolve. let's use the radial snare to create an interesting effect, especially for a tornado. You can control the strength right here. I'm going to leave it at 5, but to animate this, we need the time variable and multiply it with the vector 2, which is going to be called the noise speed. Change the default value of 0.5 on the y-axis and connect it to the multiply to the offset. Here we got a very interesting effect going on. If you save it, you kind of start seeing as something interesting, especially on our tornado mesh. The next step, we're going to create another simple noise, change it into 20, but instead of a radial snare, we are going to use something crazy, which is a twirl. This will create that swirling and twirling motion in our simple noise. Then create a vector 2 for this twirl center, then a float for the twirl amount, and then another vector 2 for the twirl speed. Change the y-axis of the twirl speed into 0.5. Twirl center will also have 0.5 and 0.5 on both x and y axis. Finally, the twirl amount default will only have 2. Let's connect it to the respective inputs of the twirls and then connect it to the strength twirl using the twirl amount. For twirl speed, well, first we need to add multiply and connect it to time, then we can connect it to the twirl speed and the twirl offset. Afterwards, we connect the twirl center with the center twirl. We now have two noises being very well animated, but now we must put them together by multiplying with each other. Then we connect this to the power node to control how much we want this to be visible. Create the property called noise power using a float, then connect it to the power node with the default of 1. Lastly, we multiply the color property we created in the beginning and connect it to the base color and the alpha clip threshold. Then we save it for our mesh. Now, I did not get this right the first time. It took me several attempts to get it right. Shown in these tornado meshes, the effect looks very cluttered, messy, and noisy. At first, I wasn't sure why it looked like this or why it had this weird effect all over it, but I then realized that the problem wasn't the shader graph, because I followed the right steps. The problem was that the tornado mesh shown in the screen here had a lot more edges, so of course shader graph had a hard time trying to figure out how to UV map or dissolve with this mesh that I have applied it with. So what I did was that I smoothened it out, so that way the shader graph can have a much more better time in implementing the effect that I wanted to have. Now, this is the tornado mesh I've smoothened it out, and as you can see here, the effect looks a lot more stylized, a lot more cleaner, less busy, and a lot more smoother compared to the ones I've just shown you. This is what I've improved from the previous tornado meshes by smoothing it out, and now it looks a lot more better and a lot more appealing. Next is the particle system, which is a system in Unity that allows to stimulate moving winds, clouds, smokes, all these things, and we're going to apply them to the tornado mesh that we have created. Now you're probably wondering, wait, didn't the shader graph made your tornado already? It created the look, yes, but it didn't create the effect that really sells it as, yes, this is a moving tornado. So we're going to start by creating an empty in the menu and then naming it VFX Tornado 01. Once you named your empty, it's time that you right click it and go to effects. Then on effects, we'll find the particle system. This will create the system that will allow us to make our tornado. You see here that the particle system has been activated, but we're going to have to change it in order to fit our tornado mesh. First off, we're going to go to shape and actually going to delete it. Well, not delete it, but stop it. This will give the particles you see here a straightforward line. but we have a lot more changes we need to add to it. Then we go to emissions, change the 10 into 0, go to count and change it into 1. But the changes don't stop there. Next, we're going to change the duration into 1. Then we're going to change the start lifetime into 1. Then we're going to change the start speed into 0. Shown here, now we only have one particle. But now we must add the mesh into it, change the particle. So first we're going to change it into a mesh. Then we're going to change the cube into the tornado mesh we have. Increase it, you see it right here. We're going to remove the view and turn it into local. Then rotate it to its proper place and apply the shaded graph material. And here we can dissolve it and change it to however we feel that would fit for our tornado effect. Right here, we have our tornado mesh. But if you want some movement, go to rotation over lifetime, change the angular velocity to 0, and then you can manipulate the y-axis to wherever movement or rotation you want the tornado to go. And the next step is to layer the tornado. Now this one is just repeating the steps I've went through through the shader graphs and the particle and different particle effects, naming them wind, top wind, dark dust clouds to layer on top of it. So you're just repeating the different process and just layering on top of the different particle effect meshes you've added onto it. And by doing so, we will have a full length tornado. Thus concludes our procedural animation on the tornado. It was difficult at times for it to get it to work, but overall it was a fascinating experience, and I hope you enjoy what I've made.